Good evening. My name is Mark Godleski, and I am the Assistant Dean for Student Development. And welcome to Le Moyne College. Thank you for taking time out of your schedule to hear from one of the leaders in the growing global movement of men working to promote gender equality and prevent gender violence, Dr. Jackson Katz. We are grateful to collaborate with Vera House and bring Dr. Jackson Katz to Central New York. Special thanks to Randy Bregman, George Kilpatrick, Tiffany Breck, and Anne Bersani for all their coordination with this evening's program. Before we begin, I'd like to point out the two exits in the rear and an exit over here to my left. Also, please note that there are restrooms on this floor. If you exit to your left, the men's restroom is approximately 25 yards on the left. The women's is about 50 yards on your right. You have to go a little further down the hallway. Those are not exact measurements, but pretty close. And now, without further ado, I'd like to invite George Kilpatrick to introduce our featured speaker. George?
Thank you, Mark, and thank you once again to Le Moyne College for their extraordinary partnership for this event tonight. My name is George Kilpatrick, Men's Outreach Coordinator here at Vera House. And before we continue, I wanted to first recognize our ASL Sign Language interpreters, Tricia Swartz and Michelle Pilchin. Thank you for doing what you do. At Vera House, of course, we're committed to making sure that all of our programs are accessible, and yes, we are indeed a safe space. Vera House, if you don't know, provides comprehensive domestic violence, sexual assault, and elder abuse prevention and intervention services, and we sincerely appreciate your interest in how we can all have a role in preventing and ending gender-based violence. In fact, our vision is a world free of violence and abuse, and your presence here tonight affirms our commitment to that vision. My work involves working with the 12 Men model and a number of different outreach programs to men, where we engage men in conversations where they invite the people that they know, the people that they run with, their crew, the people that they have the most influence over, to get them in a room to allow them to engage one another in challenging the issues that we've all grown up with that perpetuate domestic violence and sexual assault. So why are you here tonight? Well, some of you, we've had conversations. Some of you are participants in our 12-men model, and some of you have had us over for educational programs and services. But ladies and gentlemen, tonight it's time to go a little bit deeper. And so we're hoping that at the end of this program, your commitment, your drive, your interest, your passion is renewed, and you're going to take another step. For the work that you've done so far, we thank you, but for the work that's yet to be done, we hold you accountable, and we hope that you will take the commitment. And we have some commitment sheets on the chairs that you can sign a little bit later on. Now, we want to thank the Department of Justice, Office of Violence Against Women, and the New York State Department of Health, Enough is Enough grants for their support of tonight's program. We really could not have done it without them. So give it up for them. And part of, before we introduce our speaker, part of the work that we do, as we explained, is prevention and education. And so in order for you to get a sense of what that prevention and education looks like and a little bit of a sample of the work that we do, we'd like to show you this video, and it's called To Be a Man.
I'm a ride or die type of guy. This means that my loyalty is unwavering, and I will never hesitate to throw that first punch. So if you ask me, what does it really mean to be a man? For me, it means being strong.
Even when I'm weak.
It means holding it down.
Even when there's no one there to hold me up.
And when it becomes too much, I just suck it up.
Even when I can barely hold it in. I remember being 5 years old and falling down and my coach telling me to brush it off, even though I was on the verge of tears. I remember being 10 and learning that it was an insult to be called gay. I remember being 15 and knowing that if I had to fight someone to prove that I'm not a pussy, then that's exactly what I was going to do. But then I think to my mom and all the women who made me the man that I am today. The women who taught me how to love and how to nurture are the same strong women who gave me my ethics and my values. And if these women are strong, then so am I. And with this newfound strength, I have some confessions to make that don't necessarily align with the dominant story. I like to cook, and I am great at it. I also play the violin, and my hidden obsession is dancing with the stars. So I'm tired of acting like I don't care. I'm tired of shrinking myself down to fit this idea of what a real man is. I'm tired of loyalty meaning bros before hoes and me worrying about whether or not I'm being a cock block. I'm tired of performing.
It's been happening to me for as long as I can remember. It happened to my father, and it's happening to my brothers. Masculinity can be this uncompromising force that suffocates me, and with every breath I sweat until there is nothing left but a puppet waiting to take the stage. A puppet whose hard exterior protects him from feeling anything warm, like love, joy, and happiness for too long.
But tonight I will take my final bow because I am done. I quit. I will no longer let your narrative be my reality. I will no longer be society's puppet because I now know that the dominant story, your story, is not the only story. And with every step I take away from you, I learn that I no longer have to take your cues to tell me how to walk, how to talk, how to dress, or what to think.
We think that because we are strong, we cannot be wrong. And because we are alike, we are right. But this is what makes us puppets. Masculinity cannot afford introspection because it's a form of self-reflection that requires us to question everything. So I ask again, what does it really mean to be a man? When we tell our young boys,
man up,
stop being a bitch,
don't cry,
and we excuse their violence by saying,
boys will be boys.
He hit you because he liked you.
It was just locker room talk. Each is an excuse for abuse, so let us not get it confused.
This is a men's issue.
And as soon as we decide to be a part of the solution, we can start to clean up this pollution that has given rise to toxic masculinity.
My masculinity cannot fit in a box.
My masculinity will not conform.
My masculinity is diverse.
But most importantly,
my masculinity is my own.
Thank you to Vera House Prevention Educators Eric and Anthony McGriff, who wrote and performed that, and to Vera House board member Solon Quinn for donating his production of that video. And we're in the midst of a White Ribbon campaign. This is White Ribbon Campaign Month, and so you can see many of us are wearing white ribbons. And that is, of course, one of the reasons why we invited Jackson Katz here today, because when we thought about what we could do during this month to really drive the message home about what men can do to be a leader in gender violence prevention, we thought, let's call Jackson Katz. Why? Well, let me tell you why. Jackson Katz, he's an educator, an author, a filmmaker, and a cultural theorist who is internationally renowned for his pioneering scholarship and activisms on issues of gender, race, and violence. In 1993, Dr. Katz co-founded the Mentors in Violence Prevention Program at Northeastern University Center for the Study of Sport in Society, a program that Vera House actively uses right now with our education programs. The Mixed Gender Multiracial MVP Program is one of the longest running and most widely influential sexual assault and relationship abuse prevention programs in colleges, high schools, sports culture, and the military in North America and beyond. It has been implemented by numerous teams in the NFL, that's National Football League, the CFL, the Canadian Football League, the National Basketball Association, and Major League Baseball, as well as NASCAR, and many other sports organizations. Among its many accomplishments, MVP introduced the bystander approach to the gender violence prevention field, and Katz is one of the key architects of this now broadly popular approach. In 1997, Katz created and directed the first gender violence prevention program in the history of the U.S. Marine Corps. How timely is that now? Since then, he and his colleagues have been certainly centrally involved in the development and implementation of system-wide prevention efforts in the U.S. Air Force, Navy, and Army. Katz is the creator of Tough Guys and Tough Guys 2, the award-winning and widely used educational documentaries. He is also the author of The Macho Paradox, Why Some Men Hurt Women and How All Men Can Help, and Man Enough, Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton, and the Politics of Presidential Masculinity. He has a blog on masculinities and politics on the Huffington Post, and he's featured in the films Misrepresentation and The Mask You Live In, and has appeared on radio and TV programs across North America, Europe, Asia, Australia, including The Oprah Winfrey Show, Good Morning America. And his TED Talk, which you all should watch when you leave here tonight, Violence Against Women is a Men's Issue, has been viewed more than 3 million times at last count. Katz is a former high school football star, became the first man at the University of Massachusetts Amherst to earn a minor in women's studies. He holds a master's degree from the Harvard Graduate School of Education and a PhD in cultural studies and education from UCLA. A native of Boston, he lives with his family in the Los Angeles area. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a Central New York first time ever welcome to Dr. Jackson Katz.
Thanks, that was great.
Thanks, Greg.
Thank you. Thank you very much. George Kilpatrick deserves a big round of applause for all his leadership and activism. And I want to thank George as well as Randy and all the other Vera House folks who made possible tonight. I kind of just parachute in and do my thing, but all the hard work of producing an event takes place long before I get here. So thank you for all of that, and thank you for coming out this evening. I appreciate being part of your community for this brief time, and Lemoyne College as well. Thank you for hosting this. Is it going to be okay, or am I going to offend Central New York sensibilities if I step out from behind this podium? You sure?
Yeah.
It's not going to destroy my intellectual authority? It's going to be okay?
Yeah.
All right, I think I will definitely step out from behind the podium. I might return to it for comfort, but I my pedagogical style is much more interactive than is suggested by a stale podium. And actually, can I share with you a brief anecdote from my own experience that might make sense of why I even make an issue of the podium? So I give a lot of talks, right, and do a lot of trainings all over the United States and parts of the world. And a few years ago, I was in Palm Springs, California, long way from Central New York, and I was set to do a three-hour block of instruction for a group of police chiefs from throughout the Southern California region. And for someone like me, this is a great opportunity because police chiefs have a lot of power, and I had 3 hours with them. And this group was about 90 chiefs, 97% of whom are white. The overwhelming majority of them are white men. And, you know, police chiefs tend to be a rather conservative group. I was introduced, and I walked into the room. The door to the room was near the podium. I hadn't been in the room previously because somebody else had been on stage. And I stood behind the podium, and I got a sense from the body language of some of the chiefs that there was some reticence being communicated non-verbally, because I got the distinct feeling there were some people in the room who were trying to communicate that they were not particularly thrilled that I was on the 3 hours on the agenda. And so I'm thinking, okay, I'm an educator, I want to try to loosen the group up. So I said, do you mind if I step out from behind the podium? And one of the chiefs yells out, yeah, it makes you a better target. So it didn't start out particularly well that day. But let me say, I thought it was fine. And I'm an educator, and I'm not going to let this guy intimidate me. And so it was, let's go. But also, I knew the moment that chief opened his mouth that he had given me a great gift, which is to say an anecdote that I could use in my talks for years and years right here in, you know, right here in Syracuse, New York, all these years later. So however inadvertently the chief was supporting my work, wasn't he? And by the way, let me just say, I don't think that the measure of success in an educational interaction is homogeneity of opinion or unanimity of opinion and everybody agreeing with everything. That's a ridiculous aspiration, really. If you get people thinking, you challenge people to think outside the box, if you get people to challenge some of their calcified opinions and attitudes and beliefs, then you're doing your job. So the fact that it was a bit contentious, I was fine with that. Just wanted to say that. Now, I don't see the same level of reticence communicated non-verbally in this room, but then again, I haven't really said much controversial of a controversial nature quite yet. And I say that because I am going to say some things that are provocative and deliberately provocative, because there's some serious stuff going on in our society and in the world, and life is short. And it's like, if we want to make a difference, we gotta get moving. I mean, there's so much violence and unnecessary suffering in our society and all over the world. And so I am going to say some strong statements, and I am going to give you the opportunity to ask questions or make quick comments at various points, not just at the very end. If you so desire, I'm just telling you right now, the time will go by quickly, so if I give you the opportunity to ask a question or make a comment, take advantage of it, okay? All right, thank you. Just a quick survey, I asked the dean earlier, but how many people here are Lemoyne folks, whether it's students, faculty, or staff, or administration? And how many are community people who aren't directly involved with Lemoyne? And how many people don't respond to these sorts of surveys? I didn't think I saw 100% compliance. Thank you. All right. I was just curious. I'm just curious. No other agenda. So I'm going to begin with a paradigm-shifting perspective on the issues of gender violence. And I'm going to use the word gender violence inclusive of sexual assault, sexual harassment, the sexual abuse of children, domestic violence, teen relationship abuse. That whole range of issues that I'll refer to in shorthand as gender violence issues have historically been seen as women's issues that some good men help out with. That is today, even in 2017, the status quo of so many people's thinking. These are women's issues fundamentally, and there are some good men who help out. But I have a problem with that, and I don't accept the premise. And in fact, I'm going to argue that these are men's issues, first and foremost. And I know that this is consistent to a certain extent with Anthony and Eric's video and George's project at Vera House. But I'm going to argue that these are men's issues. And I'm going to spend some good time talking about that. But let me clearly emphasize that I obviously know that they're women's issues, right? Women are directly affected on so many levels across the racial and ethnic spectrum, across the socioeconomic spectrum. Women are directly impacted on a personal level and every other way. But also, even more than that, women's leadership has been utterly transformative globally on these very issues. Women's leadership has been incredible, and I'm gonna spend some time talking about women's leadership before I shift gears to talk about men. Let's talk to begin with, about domestic violence. You know, men had been beating women in relationships for thousands of years. But there was no such thing as a battered women's program until the 1970s. There weren't battered women's shelters and 800 numbers for counselor, you know, and you know, for people to call. And there weren't trained counselors on college campuses and in communities who had trained to deal with victims and survivors. There weren't police and law enforcement officials who were trained to deal, not sensitively, but professionally with these issues in the way that some of us expect today. None of that was the case until women in this country and outside this country, in a multiracial, multi-ethnic sense, organized and said, we need services for victims and survivors. There were men who were allies of those women, there's no doubt, but women's leadership made it happen. There's no question about that. Sexual assault, men had been raping women, children, and other men for thousands of years, but there was no such thing as a rape crisis center until the 1970s. There weren't 800 numbers to call for victims and survivors. There weren't trained counselors in communities or on college and university campuses to deal with these issues with survivors. And in fact, there was very little accountability in either sexual assault or domestic violence, very little accountability for offenders. Until the 1970s, roughly. Can I give you an example of the lack of accountability that, by the way, women were central in pushing for? In the United States, there were several states as late as the 1980s where it was legal for a man to rape his wife. That's in the United States. And in the Uniform Code of Military Justice, that's the military law manual, it was legal for a man to rape his wife until the 1990s in the United States. And these laws didn't just change on their own. They changed because of pressure, mostly coming from women and, of course, some male allies. And by the way, there's close to 1 billion people in the world today who live in countries where it is still legal for a man to rape his wife. So we have a long way to go, but there has been progress. And by the way, in case anybody's wondering, I know that there's sometimes women are guilty of domestic violence in the family and in relationships, and sometimes women are guilty of sexual assault as well. I'm focusing on the much bigger problem of men and men's perpetration in the course of my speaking here. And I'm also clear, and I want to be clear, that it's not just men and women, that there are people who don't fall into the binary category of men and women, that gender is a bigger spectrum than that. I appreciate that, and that'll be through the course of the presentation as well. But the point is, women's leadership has been and continues to be utterly transformative in terms of what we expect in our society, in terms of the treatment for victims and survivors, in terms of the accountability for offenders, and in terms of prevention programming. Because women, on top of all the other stuff they were doing, women were the ones who were seen as responsible for doing the educational work and the prevention work. And you know, one of the misconceptions that people have about women's leadership and advocacy in these areas is that they somehow think that women and girls have benefited, but men and boys, not so much. Like men and boys, you know, we're just kind of hanging out there. Women and girls, yeah, they have these services, but men and boys, we haven't really been affected that much. And some people even think that women's progress or progress for women and girls has come at the expense of men and boys, which is, to me, utterly ridiculous point of view, but some people hold it. But I think more people believe that it's just kind of men and boys haven't been that much affected. And I think this is a big misconception, because I think men and boys' lives have been profoundly affected in a very positive way by women's leadership and advocacy. And I'm going to give you two examples to make my case. The first has to do with domestic violence, right? In the domestic violence field, for the past 20 years, we've been talking about the effects of domestic violence on children. Right? All the children who are growing up in homes where their father abuses their mother's boyfriend abuses their mother, sometimes the mother is the abuser. And this is true in gay male relationships, in lesbian relationships, and other arrangements. There are lots of kids, sadly, growing up in homes, even as we speak, where they're being traumatized by domestic violence, right? Well, there's a term that people have used in the field. Some of you have heard or used this term. It's called children who witness domestic violence. And some people shorthand that to say children who witness. This is a term that I don't like and I don't use. You know why? Because if you're a 7-year-old kid cowering in the closet as your father or another man is raging against your mother, you're not a witness. You're a victim. You're not observing something happening to somebody else. You're experiencing it happening to yourself. The experience of trauma is much more immediate and profound than is suggested by the passive word witness. Well, guess what? The category of children who are being thusly traumatized includes not just girls, but also boys. Do you have any idea how many boys right now in the state of New York are growing up in homes where they're being traumatized in this way? Do you have any idea how many boys are in the juvenile system in the state of New York, in part because their life journey started out as traumatized boys, as children, early adolescents, et cetera, who are traumatized, and they couldn't figure out a way not to take the traditional path that we give to boys who have been thusly traumatized, which is somebody took something from me, I'm going to take it from somebody else, which is why boys who have been abused are something like 10 times more likely to become abusive of others than boys who haven't been abused. The prisons of the United States and of the state of New York are filled with chronologically adult men who are little boys underneath the bluster and the tatted up bodies and the bad, they're little boys who in many instances armed themselves and armored themselves as young boys against the reality of what the circumstances they came from. And by the way, I'm not defending bad behavior by boys and men if what got them into jail or prison was bad behavior or antisocial behavior. I'm not making an excuse for that behavior. we are big enough, we have big enough brains that we can walk and chew gum at the same time. We can hold individuals accountable for their behavior and take a step back and understand what are the social and systemic forces that are producing these predictable outcomes. It's not one or the other. This is such ignorance to think that somehow trying to explain why things are happening sociologically is a way to make excuses for people to act badly. That is not what I'm saying. And by the way, I understand and appreciate that if we're going to talk about it, and we need to talk about it, and those of you who are young, it's on your shoulders in a certain sense of your generation to undo the horrendous effects of the system of mass incarceration that we have today. If one of the things we have to talk about, if we're going to talk about mass incarceration, we have to talk about poverty, and we have to talk about racism, because poverty and racism are two giant systems that have a direct impact on who ends up in prison. Let's be just flat out clear about that, right? I mean, there's all kinds of young, white, middle-class kids who are doing things on a regular basis that aren't getting surveyed by the state, that aren't getting arrested, that aren't getting records, that aren't going to jail, that aren't going to prison, and it's been that way for 50 years. And that's about privilege, both class and race. But we also have to talk about violence against boys and violence against young men, because that's another giant system that is partly producing some of the behaviors and some of the then results that we see. You know, feminist theorists and activists have been saying this for decades, that we've got to break down this artificial distinction between the private sphere of the family and the public sphere. There's all kinds of reasons why that's a problematic dichotomy. One of the reasons is because women are kept sort of subordinate and in second-class status by keeping them from, if you will, the public sphere. But there's also another reason, because there's a direct relationship between the public and private sphere on many levels. And when it comes to violence, there's so many connections. You know, there was a study recently that showed that of mass shootings, and mass shootings is an extremely common occurrence in the United States, one of the sort of one of the many global embarrassments of our country. If you travel internationally, people think we're just out of control in this country. And they're right. I mean, about violence, they're certainly right. Because compared to the other wealthy countries in the world, we're just off the charts. But, I mean, mass shootings, there was a study that showed that over the past 5 years, 57% of mass shootings had a domestic violence connection. 57% of mass shootings had a domestic violence connection, which is to say the perpetrator was either the perpetrator or victim of domestic violence in 57% of the shootings. Now, how are we going to talk about mass shootings and not talk about domestic violence? It seems like an obvious avenue of inquiry, don't you think? But by the way, just a parenthetical note, when's the last time you saw domestic violence experts talking on CNN after the latest mass shooting? When's the last time you saw batterer intervention counselors who know so much about abusive men talked to and interviewed and spending time on the mainstream organs of communication in the United States after a mass shooting? There's practically no time left after you finish with the FBI profilers and the, you know what I mean, and the law enforcement types and the lawyers arguing back and forth about what's going to be evidence that's going to be acceptable in court and things like that. It's like we have so much insight into this behavior, it doesn't get the light of day in the mainstream media. It's unbelievable to me. It's so frustrating. But that's, you know, but this connection between what's going on in the family and what's going on in the streets, if you want a bumper sticker for that point, there's no peace on the streets if there's no peace in the family. There's no peace in the community if there's no peace at home. There's no peace in the world if there's no peace at home. So much of the bad behavior committed by boys and men in the world has some of its roots in boys and young men's lives in their families and in their childhoods and their adolescence, so much of it. And you could, you know, look this up, do the research. We have to break down some of that false distinction. And a part of the reason why I got involved in this work a long time ago was I kind of got this early on, that these aren't, domestic and sexual violence aren't just issues unto themselves. They're also deeply connected to all kinds of other systems of power and illegitimate use of power and violence and inequality, and that the roots go deep. I just gave you one example. But back to my earlier point about the misconception that people have about women's leadership and how it's affected boys and men, the second area has to do with sexual violence and male sexual victimization. We're having a conversation in our society about men as the victims of sexual violence, right? Men have been sexually assaulting other men and boys, again, for thousands and thousands of years. And sometimes it's ritually practiced and socially sanctioned and embedded in institutional and cultural practice, both in this country but also all over the world. But it's only been about the past 15 years that we're really talking about this publicly. And this is a big step forward. And you know, I work in all branches of the US military, and I have been for almost 20 years, right? And we're having this conversation for the past 5 years or so in the military about male sexual victimization. And I don't know if anybody here has been part of this conversation, but some people who aren't part of the work know that there's a sexual assault problem in the military. What they don't know often is that men are the victims of a lot of the sexual violence in the military. Now, I don't know the exact percentage of the victims that are men, and I know that there's been a statistical kind of debate in the last couple of years about what percentage of victims of sexual violence in the military are men. But the debate is not between people who say on the one hand that it's 5% and other people on the other hand say it's 7%. The debate is more like, is it 25% or is it 40%? I mean, in other words, it's way higher than people think. Men are the overwhelming perpetrators of sexual violence in the military, but men are also a significant percentage of the victims. Another example of popular sort of conversation, has anybody here seen the movie Spotlight? How many people have seen the movie Spotlight? Okay. I can't resist giving you a piece, the people who didn't raise your hand, giving you a piece of advice. So forgive me, okay? I'm gonna indulge myself. I'm guessing that a lot of you like to see movies, right? It's a popular thing in our culture, see movies. Here's a good idea, right? Or it's just a piece of advice. When a movie wins the Oscar for Best Picture, it's a good thing to see that movie. And I live in LA, okay? I'm from Boston, but I live in LA. So you know how we're obsessed with movies even more than the average American out there. I know that. But you can't go wrong if you see the Best Picture, because it's the actual movie that the most sophisticated people in the cinematic arts have decided is the most successful piece of art that year. Even if you don't necessarily feel drawn to the subject matter, you can't go wrong in terms of the quality of the cinema, because it's the Best Picture. Spotlight won Best Picture 3 years ago, and it is about the Catholic Church sexual abuse scandal, the epicenter of which was in my home city of Boston. And it followed the story of the Boston Globe newspaper's investigative journalism team called the Spotlight Team, which investigated the Catholic Church sexual abuse scandal, where the church was reassigning priests who were sexually abusing girls and boys and not holding them accountable and then putting more kids at risk. And it blew up as a scandal both in Boston. And by the way, the Boston Globe was facing lots of pressure from the church, because the Catholic Church was very powerful in Boston, and they persisted. And they did good journalism. And it became a global scandal, not just a local scandal. And then it spread to other religious institutions and other cherished institutions. And this is a good thing, because this is uncovering, you know, bad behavior and institutional malfeasance in a way that was very, I think, very healthy. It was a good thing. But the Spotlight team, a Spotlight movie, highlighted this story. And the filmmakers, when they won the Oscar, gave a shout out to survivors of sexual abuse and sexual violence. And it was a good positive moment. And again, the point here is that this is a good thing. We're talking now about men and boys as victims of sexual violence. And boys and men who are those victims deserve, and survivors deserve, all of our respect, support, and treatment as much as, you know, women or others. Absolutely true. But why do you think we're having the conversation now about male sexual victimization? And who do you think is responsible for that conversation? Who do you think were the first people to engage that conversation? Guess who? It was feminist women in the 1970s who were talking about the sexual abuse of boys. In the 1970s. But when was the last time you heard feminist women given credit for opening up cultural space for a conversation about male sexual victimization? You're more likely to hear ignorant comments about how they hate men, they're bashing men, what about all the male victims and all that kind of ignorance from people who don't even know their own history. And you know, the men and young men and boys who walk the path, who walk down the trail of going from victim to survivor, in other words, I'm not gonna no longer gonna be shamed into silence because I'm not the one who should be ashamed, I'm gonna reclaim the narrative of my life, I'm gonna be a survivor, etc. And people who have the courage to do that, it's a courageous thing, some people aren't ready to do that, but the people who do, it's a courageous act, but they're walking down a trail that's already been blazed. And guess who it's been blazed by? The women in the battered women's and domestic and sexual assault movements who had created that paradigm long before. But again, you almost never hear any of this in the public conversation, do you? You're much more likely to hear about all those women in domestic violence and sexual assault world who've got a chip on their shoulder, they hate men, they've got an agenda against men, they're bashing men, and similar levels of ignorance being presented as if it's fact, don't you? So if there's nothing else you remember in my talk tonight, next time you hear the women in this movement or in this work criticized for being anti-male, remember some of the things, I hope, some of the things that I've been saying, because so many men and boys' lives have been improved as a result of that work. And by the way, if I just make one further sort of argument to bolster my point, look at all the men and boys who have women close to us who have been assaulted by other men. Like, we're not victims ourselves? Like, we're not secondary trauma victims? Like, all the men in this room who have women and girls close to us who have been assaulted by other men? Like, we don't have to suffer as well from, because we care about somebody who has been the victim of sexual violence or domestic violence or harassment or abuse? There's millions of men. No, there's billions of men in this category. And by the way, one thing people say to me often is like, why would men get involved in this work? And maybe the men who are involved, there must be something that was personal about it for them. They must have had some woman in their life who was assaulted. There must be a reason why a guy like me or George or other men in this room got involved, because why else would a man really care unless it was something close to him, right? If that were the only measure of why men get involved, there would be billions of men involved, because there's billions of men in the world who have women and girls close to us who have been assaulted by other men. It's a lot more than just whether individual men have women close to us. Because, like I said, if that were the case, we wouldn't have to be struggling to try to find more men to come out and actually get involved in this work. There's a lot more going on. Now, I've talked all about how women have been leaders in all of this and continue to be. And can I say, this is March, Women's History Month. How many people, by the way, know that March is Women's History Month? And how many, honestly, how many people didn't really know until I just said it? Okay. I just want to say a word about March being Women's History Month. Why do we have a Women's History Month? Is it because the month of March is somehow, you know, special in women's history? It's similar to why we have Black History Month in February. In each case, it wasn't the month in particular, although there were some reasons why they chose these months. It wasn't about the month in particular of March, like why to focus on it. The idea was to do Black History Month and Women's History Month as a corrective against the exclusion and marginalization of people, you know, African-American people and women and their contributions to American culture and history. Because it wasn't so long ago that women's and African-American people and people of color more generally, their contributions to American history and culture were so overlooked and marginalized in history and history teaching and history textbooks. There'd be whole chapters about different periods, like, say, of American history, and then at the end, there'd be a little paragraph. Women were also present during this period, and they played important roles, and that kind of thing. You follow me? So the idea was to create a special month where you called special focus on women's contributions to American, you know, history, African-American contributions, et cetera, as a corrective. Again, the idea is you make yourself obsolete eventually, because eventually there won't have to be a special month, because it will be so integrated into people's understanding of our society and history that you don't need to call it out in a special way. But we're not there yet. We're not even close to being there yet. I mean, I was just at an event in LA a few weeks ago where it's called Makers. Some of you might have heard of it, but this is an organization. The whole idea of the organization is to create monuments and name of streets and names of, you know, different public spaces after women of accomplishment. Because if you go into major cities around the country, it's like monument after monument. There's no very few women. And there's very few people of color, too. As if, you know, white guys in the Revolutionary War period are the only people who have really made major contributions to American history. I mean, so this whole idea is part of the change that has to happen is we have to acknowledge what's already there as opposed to, telling a story about aspirationally about what could happen in the future. It's also what's already happened and what's already been a part of our culture. But the women, let me just say, who built the battered women's and domestic and sexual violence movements are and have been making history for now several decades, because this is all world-changing work. It's not some marginal issue here. This is big stuff. And it's frankly the front edge of gender equality promotion. Working against men's violence against women is the front edge of promoting gender equality. And as far as I'm concerned, promoting gender equality is one of the front edge issues of the human species. And that's, again, that big a deal. This is not some marginal issue. Now, I've been saying that these are men's issues, not women's issues that good men help out with. I'm also going to argue that these are leadership issues for men. And what do I mean by that? Well, I mean that if you're a man and you're a leader, or a young man who aspires to leadership, you need to know that you have to know about domestic and sexual violence and all the other issues that intersect with it. And then you have to figure out what you can do as a man to prevent it from happening, to hold people accountable, to help victims and survivors. Not because you're a nice guy helping out the women, but because you're a leader or you aspire to be a leader. And we expect that in the 21st century of men who are or want to be leaders. Right? This is a shift. Because right now, a lot of people don't see these issues in this way. I see it this way. This is fundamentally a leadership issue. And when I say, again, leadership can be at many different levels. It can be in your family, in your faith community, in politics, in business, in sports culture, in media. It can be formal or informal. There's all kinds of leadership. And I don't want to just confine it to the realm of, you know, some high status leader, because a lot of people don't see themselves in that way. But leadership can play out in many different levels. Now, I want to share with you an example of men's leadership. But I want to, and it's going to be a clip that Anthony's going to help me with in a moment. But I want to explain to you where it comes from. So, as George said in his introduction, I and my colleagues have been working with the U.S. military since 1997. And in the Q&A, if you want to talk about the Marine Corps, I'm happy to talk about it. I'm serious, because we were so far ahead of the curve in the Marine Corps until they went in a different direction. We were so far ahead of the curve in dealing with the very kind of issues that surfaced in this scandal. We started in 1997 in the Marine Corps. Anyways, we've been working with, however, the Australian Army since 2011. Has anybody here been to Australia? Are there any Aussies in the house? No? Okay. I know that Australia is very far away, and it's very expensive to get there. Yeah, it's a commitment, but it's a very interesting place, Australia, very interesting place. And it's warm year-round, by the way, in case you didn't know that. Australia is a warm country. In fact, the climate where 90% of the people in Australia live is just like Southern California. But anyways, there was a scandal that happened in the Australian Army. This might sound familiar to those of you who have been following the news in this country in the last 3 or 4 weeks. It was a scandal where a group of junior officers and junior enlisted leaders, all men, were making a series of really sexually degrading Facebook posts referring to their fellow female soldiers in totally inappropriate and degrading ways. And it wasn't just one or two, it was many dozens of posts and over a period of weeks. And of course they were caught, just like the Marines were caught, because this is the digital age. And so you get caught. So in addition to being ethically challenged, these guys were ignoramuses to think they were somehow going to get away with this. Really, think about the decision-making process. Be a member of the Australian Army or the United States Marine Corps and think you're going to get away with this in the digital age. Anyways, The general who was then the chief of the army, which is the second highest ranking member of the Australian military, General David Morrison, made a videotaped statement in response to the scandal, which was then released to all the members of the Australian army, and then it went viral beyond. And I want to share with you General Morrison's statement as an example of the kind of leadership that we don't see very much of at all in our society or, frankly, in Australian society, especially from a man of that level of institutional authority and stature. So, Anthony, if you could roll the Chief of Army clip, please.
Earlier today, I addressed the media, and through them the Australian public, about ongoing investigations into a group of officers and NCOs whose conduct, if proven, has not only brought the Australian Army into disrepute, but has let down every one of you and all of those whose past service has won the respect of our nation. There are limits to how much I can tell you because the investigations into this network by both the New South Wales Police and the ADF Investigative Service are ongoing. But evidence collected to date has identified a group of men within our ranks who have allegedly produced highly inappropriate material demeaning women and distributed it across the internet and Defence's email networks. If this is true, then the actions of these members are in direct contravention to every value the Australian Army stands for. By now, I assume you know my attitude to this type of conduct. I have stated categorically many times that the Army has to be an inclusive organisation in which every soldier, man and woman, is able to reach their full potential and is encouraged to do so. Those who think that it is okay to behave in a way that demeans or exploits their colleagues have no place in this Army. Our service has been engaged in continuous operations since 1999 and in its longest war ever in Afghanistan. On all operations, female soldiers and officers have proven themselves worthy of the best traditions of the Australian Army. They are vital to us maintaining our capability now and into the future. If that does not suit you, then get out. You may find another employer where your attitude and behaviour is acceptable, but I doubt it. The same goes for those who think that toughness is built on humiliating others. Every one of us is responsible for the culture and reputation of our Army and the environment in which we work. If you become aware of any individual degrading another, then show moral courage and take a stand against it. No one has ever explained to me how the exploitation or degradation of others enhances capability or honours the traditions of the Australian Army. I will be ruthless in ridding the Army of people who cannot live up to its values, and I need every one of you to support me in achieving this. The standard you walk past is the standard you accept. That goes for all of us, but especially those who by their rank have a leadership role. If we are a great national institution, if we care about the legacy left to us by those who have served before us, if we care about the legacy we leave to those who, in turn, will protect and secure Australia, then it is up to us to make a difference. If you're not up to it, find something else to do with your life. There is no place for you amongst this band of brothers and sisters.
Now, can you imagine if we lived in a society where it was not exceptional to hear a man of that rank and stature talk like that and not just be checking the box, but actually mean it? Can you imagine? I can imagine. You know what I can imagine? A society with radically and dramatically reduced rates of domestic violence, sexual assault, sexual harassment, gay bashing, bullying, and other forms of interpersonal violence. You know why I say that? Because the typical perpetrator of these crimes and these abuses is not a sick man. He's not a sociopath. He's not mentally ill. He's not deeply disturbed. There are those individuals, but the typical perpetrator is much more normal than that. But that, you know what? That makes a lot of people very uncomfortable. Because a lot of people would prefer the typical perpetrator to be some kind of monster, because then we can dissociate ourselves from him and say, well, that guy's just whack. You know, some people invoke these metaphysical sort of justifications or explanations. It's just evil. You just can't, you have to reconcile yourself to the presence of evil in the world. Hey, maybe that's true on one level, but there's a lot that we can do on this world. There's a lot we can do, and there's a lot of predictable forces that are producing the current outcomes. And by the way, this monster idea, that perpetrators are monsters, one of the ways that racism functions in this particular discourse is that for some white people, not all white people, for some white people, there's a comfort in saying somehow that the racialized other is the carrier of this disease or somehow. So when a man of color, for example, is abusive to his wife or a girlfriend or another woman or girl, some white people will say under their breath or even out loud, that's a cultural thing for those people. That's how they treat their women in that culture. When white guys do it, it's almost always ascribed to individual characteristics like psychopathology, or he had a brain injury, or a bad childhood, or alcohol drug problem, or lost his job. When a man of color does it, it's more likely to be attributed to a quote-unquote cultural thing. And then there's another discourse that's happening in this country now. It's like we're importing bad men who are doing bad things. These immigrants are coming in and creating havoc, when we know the vast an overwhelming majority of the violence is homegrown right here in the United States, right in white middle-class communities and in poor black communities and Latino, every community, right? But again, it's so predictable, this sort of desire to look elsewhere rather than to be introspective, the desire to blame the outsider, the other, rather than to be introspective, which takes more guts, basically. Because to be introspective means you have to have the courage to look inward, both individually as individual people, but also as a society. And that's some of the forces that we're working against in trying to create a healthier society, is some of these impulses. I want to share with you a positive aspect of leadership, because it's not all, you know, it's not all hell and damnation. There's some good stories. And I don't know if some of you saw this particular story, but I'm going to share with you a clip that Anthony's going to help me on in a moment as well, of an example of young boys and girls who took some leadership on the issues of gender equality and gender justice. And some of you might have heard about this story. It's just like ripped from the headlines just a couple weeks ago in New Jersey. And it's about a CYO basketball team. Do you know this story? How many people know the story of the CYO basketball team in New Jersey? Okay, let me give you a quick setup. There was a league it was a Catholic youth organization, which I, by the way, played CYO basketball when I was a kid, when I was a young guy. I used to wear my chai, and I played for St. John's. I like I'm a Jewish person, and I like the juxtaposition of the St. John's and the chai. But I couldn't resist telling you that. It was a boys' team, and there were a couple of girls on the team. And they were on the team because there was no girls' league in this particular age group or whatever. There was no girls' opportunity. And so it turned out that it was against the rules, but they got away with it somehow. And they played almost the whole season with these girls on the team. But then there was two games left in the season, and some of the officials in this CYO basketball league decided to say, enough is enough, and the girls can't play on the team because it's against the rules. And the team held a vote. Do you want to continue the season with just the boys, or do you want to say, we're a team and we're going to stick together or nothing? And that's the context for this story. And I want to show you the clip. So, Anthony, if you could roll the clip that's the CYO New Jersey basketball team, please.
Is your decision to play the game without the two young ladies on the team, or to stay as a team as you've played all season with the girls on the team?
Stay as a team.
Play as a team. Show of hands, play without the girls.
But if the girls play, you guys, this will be the end of your season. You really have the playoffs.
It doesn't matter.
These kids are doing the right thing. And we don't have to tell them what to do. They just know. It's amazing.
Having us all here today, supporting the girls, and for having this fun game. It's been a great season, and it's been fun having all you guys playing basketball. It's been really great. Amen.
Is your decision to play the game without the two young ladies on the team, or to stay as a team as you've played all season with the girls on the team?
Stay as a team. Show
of hands, stay on the team. Play as a team. Show of hands, play without the girls.
But if the girls play, you guys, this will be the end of your season. You won't play in the playoffs.
It doesn't matter.
These kids are doing the right thing. And what we don't have to tell them what to do, they just know. It's amazing.
Game. It's been a great season, and it's been fun having all you guys playing basketball. It's been really great. Amen.
The way we've been sticking together since they said this to us about 2 weeks ago, that was like over the top emotional.
The positive thing that we saw was that everybody came together and supported each other. Because at the end of the day, that's what Catholic school and being Christians are about. What I see here is the reason why we sent our children here.
It doesn't really occur to us that girls are on a team.
We just all play as a team. Yeah. We've been playing since third grade.
Yeah, so it's not fair that like we get to move on, but they care. So we just made it. No, like, it's not fair. So we decided that we should stay, that we should be able to stay on the team, and that we're not going to move on without our teammates.
Yeah. It's like they almost don't recognize me as female. It's just like I'm part of them just as they're part of me. And they don't want to break that belongings just like I don't want to break this belongings. Girls can be just as rough as boys. We're near the end of our season, and it made no point just to pull us off right at the end when we only had...
So there's leadership right there from a group of 10-year-olds, don't you think? All right, a couple more things, and then I'm going to open up the floor for the first time. But I want to share with you something relating to something that General Morrison said a few moments ago. At one point, he said, "The standard you walk past is the standard you accept," which is General Morrison's language for and his articulation of the bystander approach. And we actually trained General Morrison, I'm proud to say. But the bystander approach, which, again, Vera House has been part of implementing locally, and some of you know Don McPherson, my friend and colleague, Don McPherson, the former quarterback of Syracuse, and now he's become, over the past 20 years, a big figure in the field of engaging men. He succeeded me as the director of the Mentors and Violence Prevention Program, which is the first program to institute the bystander approach. And I'm just going to share with you really in a really brief overview of what that approach is, because it has applicability widely, the bystander approach, whether it's on college campuses, sexual assault prevention, in communities, in all kinds of settings. It gives a role for everybody to play. So basically, to do that, I'm going to use the board here, but I'm going to share with you a mini history of the MVP program, Mentors and Violence Prevention Program. It started in the sports culture. And let me say, the reason why I started the MVP program in the sports culture at an institute in Boston called the Center for the Study of Sport and Society was not because there was a problem in athletics of male athletes assaulting women, although there was and continues to be such a problem. My thinking was, we need to find men who already have some status in their peer culture and with younger men to start speaking out on these issues, because it'll make it easier for other men to do it. I'm convinced there's an awful lot of men in our society who are not happy with the status quo, but for whatever reason, they don't have the strength or the self-confidence to speak out. And so if you get guys who already have some status breaking the ice, if you will, it'll make it easier. That was the thinking. This is basic concept. So I thought, sports, what better place than sports? And sports has played an incredibly important role over the past century in the United States and globally in the efforts to, you know, for social justice all over the world, really. And the Center for the Study of Sport and Society had been founded in 1984 by a man named Richard Lapchick, whose father was a pioneering coach and player in the NBA, as a way to sort of organize efforts using sport as the platform. So Richard Lapchick, the son, was not an elite athlete, but he was a sort of combined athletics and civil rights activism, and founded the center in 1984. And the issue that historically the center had been most identified with was race and racism, using sport as the sort of catalyst for a discussion about race and racism. And Lapchick himself was one of the organizers of the Olympic boycott of South Africa during the apartheid era. I don't know how many people here, and especially younger people, know much about that history. It's a really important history. How many people here have seen the film Invictus, where Morgan Freeman plays God? No, sorry. He plays Nelson Mandela. And Matt Damon plays the captain of the Springboks rugby team, which was an institution in sort of white Afrikaner society. And Nelson Mandela, having just been elected president of a very divided country with a white minority rule for all those decades and centuries, and he was trying to unite the country. And one of the ways that he did that is he took as part of his national leadership the idea that he was going to stand with, as a black man, he was going to stand with this white institution, the rugby team, which was hated by the black majority of the country because it represented the white minority government that was the apartheid government. And anyways, he decided to stand with them, and the movie tells the story. There's so many ways that race and sport issues intersect and overlap. Muhammad Ali, who's the icon of using sport as a platform, just died last year, obviously. Ali said on numerous occasions that he wanted to become a famous boxer so he could have a louder voice for justice, and he, of course, went out and did it. When Jackie Robinson stepped on the field for the Brooklyn Dodgers in 1947, that wasn't just a moment in sports history, it was a moment in American history, and therefore world history, because sports is more than the playing fields. And by the way, another example of sports and society, if you will, is Title IX, when it was passed in 1972 as an omnibus educational bill. Nobody thought Title IX had, at the time, had anything to do with sexual assault. It had to do with gender equity in education. And one of the key driving forces behind Title IX was the vast disparities in funding and support for girls and women's athletics back in the day and back in the earlier decades, where girls' sports was totally marginalized. The coaches were often ill-prepared, and it was an obvious disparity. And Title IX was an attempt to rectify that disparity. And as a result of Title IX, millions of girls and women have had the opportunity to play sports and have good coaching and have all the positive experience of sports that many boys have. And that has enormous and measurable positive effects, not just in athletic terms, but in terms of life success and life skills. Anyways, sports obviously plays an important role. So I knew all this, and I approached Lapchick with the idea of creating a program to train initially college male student athletes to speak out about sexual assault and domestic violence and gay bashing and bullying. The question was, what are we going to... We got funded by the United States Department of Education to create this model program. We had 9 schools initially, big Division I athletic programs and small liberal arts schools. The question was, what are we going to say to these young men on hockey, basketball, baseball, football, lacrosse, soccer teams? What are we going to say to them that invites them into the conversation rather than indicts them as potential rapists and abusers? Right? Invites them in rather than indicts them. And I say that because back in the 70s and 80s, and by the way, I know that when I say the 70s and 80s, if you're a traditional age college student, that might as well sound like when I was your age, somebody saying the 40s and 50s. Which is like, I'm thinking black and white TV and, you know. But back in the 70s and 80s, and I'm gonna use sexual assault prevention as the example, but you could use other issues. There was a binary understanding, women and men. We didn't talk about gender nonconformity. It was women and men, and most efforts that were called sexual assault prevention efforts back in the day focused on women. They were called prevention efforts, but they were really risk reduction efforts under the name of prevention. So girls and women were taught, don't put your drink down at a party because a guy might drop a rape drug in your drink. Look in the back seat of your car before you get in, have a man's voice on the voicemail. Although the discerning listener will note that there was no such thing as voicemail in the 1970s and 80s. Right? It was answering machines. And you were lucky if you had one. It was kind of a cool thing, right? Today, answering machines are literally in museums. You know, and my 15-year-old son thinks of an answering machine as one short step away from the Sumerian, papyrus, you know what I mean? Like the... But back in the day, the focus was on women and girls, and like I said, it was risk reduction, not prevention. True prevention means going to the root cause of the problem, and the root cause of the sexual assault problem is not girls and women. When men and boys were focused on, it was almost always as perps or potential perps. So the spirit of the educational message to guys was, you guys better listen up, because some of you are doing these bad things to girls or women or other men, and if you don't listen to people like us, we know that some of you will do these things. You need to know the law in the state of New York in terms of consent, sexual consent, especially involving alcohol. The problem with going in with that attitude of, you better listen up, you better know the law, is that a lot of guys will just tune you out, and they'll just say, who do you come in here talking to me like this? I'm not a rapist or an abuser, and I resent the implication that just because I happen to be a man, I'm somehow, you know, responsible or guilty or somehow implicated in the crimes of some of these guys. And a lot of guys will just tune you out, and they'll say, I'm a good guy. This is an issue, but it's not my issue. It's a problem, but it's not my problem. Have you heard men say this? This is still in 2017, the status quo. Most men say, this is not my issue, it's not my problem. I'm a good guy. By the way, I just give you one possible response when somebody says that. How about saying this in response? We need to raise the bar a little higher for what it means to be a good guy in the United States in 2017. And just saying, I'm not a rapist is not particularly impressive to me, right? Guys shouldn't be getting high fives for saying, I don't beat my girlfriend, okay? We need more from men than that. And what do we need in a nutshell? We need more men who are willing to break our complicit silence and start speaking up and start challenging and interrupting guys around us and women around us who are acting in abusive ways. It's pretty simple stuff on a fundamental level. But the status quo back then was men were focused on as perps or potential perps. And now I do know, and I think that men and women, everybody, should know the law, and I appreciate that, but how, as an educator, can we reach men and motivate them? Well, at the time, I had a professor in graduate school who, along with his colleagues, was looking at an approach to middle school bullying prevention that moved beyond the perpetrator-victim binary. In other words, instead of focusing on the kid doing the bullying and the kid experiencing it, they focused on all the kids around the kid doing it and all the kids around the kid experiencing it. The idea was to get the kids around the kid who was bullying to make it clear to that kid that what he or she was doing was not acceptable, not because they were going to get in trouble with the authority figures like the teacher or the principal, but because the kids in the peer culture didn't approve of the behavior. Like, what you're doing is not okay, it's not cool, you know, in the peer culture. And it was to get kids around the kid experiencing it to make it clear to that kid that they were on that kid's side. In other words, we don't like what's happening to you, this is not right, and we want to do whatever you can, so how can we help? And they called that the bystander approach. And the beauty of it was that it brought everybody into the conversation. So in other words, you could no longer say, like, it's not my issue because I don't rape women or, you know, whatever. It's like everybody has a role to play. And so how we use the word bystander was anybody who is not a perpetrator or a victim in a given circumstance, but also in a given peer culture or in a given community. It's not just an incident, not just a bystander when you see an incident. It's just, how do you walk in the world? How do you carry yourself in the world, in your peer culture, in your school, on your team, in your fraternity or your sorority, in your community? How do you see yourself in relation to others and in terms of your responsibility to others, but also to yourself? And one other key point about the bystander approach, as I teach it and taught it, is that it's not just about incidents. This is why I'm telling you, I don't like the term bystander intervention. So my work and other people's work has gone in, not my work, I shouldn't say that, but some people's work, taking some of the fundamentals of my and others' work, has gone in a direction that I don't think is particularly productive towards this incident-based intervention. Okay, so it's like bystander intervention. When you see a situation, you need to, you know, jump in and do something. I think that's more like nightclub bouncer training. What I've been teaching from the beginning is much deeper than how do you react to an incident. Of course we want people to think about how they can react to an incident, but it's bigger than that. If you can imagine this triangle as a pyramid, and you can imagine the tip of the pyramid is an incident of sexual violence or domestic violence or relationship abuse or gay bashing or bullying of some kind. But the base of the pyramid is a set of attitudes, beliefs, and behaviors that create the cultural context and foundation within which the abusive act takes place. It opens up a lot more space for what we're saying a bystander can do. And I say a bystander, remember, it's a friend, a teammate, a colleague, a coworker. In other words, it's not just you see an incident of sexual violence or domestic violence, you need to do something. It's you hear a sexist joke. What do you do if you're a guy and you're in a group of guys and there's no women present and one or two of the guys start making really sexually degrading comments about girls or women and you're in the group? What do you do? And if you don't say something, what are you saying? If you're a white person and you're a group of white people and there's no people of color in the room and then one or two of those white people start making racist comments, there's no people of color in the room who are the direct object of that joke or that commentary. If you don't say something, what are you saying? Same thing with if you're a heterosexual person. In each case, if you're in a member, if you're a member of a dominant group or a group with relative social position or power, and you don't challenge other members of that group who are perpetuating some injustice, then isn't it true that your silence is a form of consent and complicity? And don't we know that attitudes influence actions? I mean, this is basic stuff. Martin Luther King, among the many, many great things that he said in his incredibly short life, was he said, in the end, what will hurt the most is not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. In the end, what will hurt the most is not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Archbishop Desmond Tutu made a similar comment. In situations of oppression, those who remain neutral take the side of the oppressor. So look at all the men out there who are good men, who don't say anything, who don't challenge other men, who don't make it clear to other men that that kind of behavior is not cool. The goal of the bystander approach, in part, is to get those men to start making it clear that sexism and its manifestations is not cool. Again, not just because they're going to get in trouble, guys are going to get in trouble for doing it, although that might be the case, but because it's the right thing to do. And I just have to say this before we open up the floor. This is harder to do since November 8th. Yeah. It's harder. Our work is harder since November 8th. Because if we're making the argument that, you know, that part of what has to happen if we want to reduce sexual assault and domestic violence and harassment is by changing the cultural context and foundation within which it takes place, what happened on November 8th is going in the opposite direction. Forgive me. All right, so I have more, but I want to get some questions. I mean, I have some video. The last portion of my presentation after this Q&A is I'm going to switch gears talk about media, and I'm going to show you some clips from my films and other people's films, and we're going to talk about the role that media plays in shaping some of these social norms, including pornography, because if we're going to change the underlying cultural conditions that give rise to and help support and perpetuate these abuses, we have to talk about media, because it's the great pedagogical force of our time. So concerns, questions, comments, and do we have a handheld mic? We do. If we need it, we have it. But just people want to ask a question or make a comment, and please know that you're speaking to the whole room, not just to me, because it's much better communication if you project as much as you can. Oh, okay, good. Thanks.
Lovely to hear everything you're having to say. I think one of the biggest issues, I do some work in this area, particularly with young men, and trying to understand how do we speak to them to have them be interested in this issue. I think one of the problems that I have come across is that it's okay to make jokes, right? Like, it's okay, there are funny rape jokes, but they're only funny when you're making fun of the culture around it. And there are funny jokes when they're being made about making fun of sexism or making fun of media's influence and these kinds of things. How have you had any experience in finding, because it's that gray area, right, where it's not, you can't make any jokes. It's not like we can't laugh about this stuff. It's just how do we explain that you can't make fun of the people who are being victimized by these actions. Right. What is sort of your thoughts on that? And how you kind of approach that with young men in particular.
Okay, thank you. It's a great question. I'll try to be concise. I mean, the reason why I say that is because this is a huge subject, and a lot of the points that people might raise, please know that just for the sake of time, I'm going to have to just give you a shorter answer, but there's so much more. One thing is I would never start with comedy. I would, if you're going to work with young men, that's a more abstract level of consciousness. You'd start with much more concrete things. You know, what you see a guy pushing his girlfriend up against a locker, you know, physical forms of violence, sexual forms of abuse, before you get to subtle things like comedy. Comedy is very complicated. So comedy is totally contextual and political, People will deny that, but it's like denying that, you know, the weather, you know, like the weather doesn't exist. You know, it's like comedy is political by definition, and the speaker matters, the listener matters, the context matters, and there's all kinds of nuance and subtlety embedded in all of that. So it's a landmine a little bit when you start talking about comedy because it's so contextual and nuanced. I think the goal, at least my goal as an educator, is to help people think critically and introspectively about their use of language, whether it's comedic or otherwise. In other words, you can't determine for somebody whether something is sexist or not, or whether you intended it to be or not. You can help them think critically and self-critically, because they're going to have to make those determinations for themselves, where those lines are, do you know? Because the same joke could be told in one context, and it could be what we would say in an academic sense is counter-hegemonic, in other words, against the enactment of illegitimate power, if you will, or it could be perpetuating illegitimate power in a different context, the same exact joke. You know what I'm saying? So it really, I think the most important thing is that if you help them to start thinking critically, especially about how it's being received. It's not the intent of the speaker that we're asking them to think about. We're asking them to think about how it's being received. So for example, like even my own son, who will make comments sometimes, knowing that his parents are on board with a lot of this, you know, sort of sophisticated understanding of language and power, and like a lot of young people will say, that's gay, about something that has nothing to do with sexual orientation, and think that it's no big deal. And then you say, well, how would you feel, you know, if there's kids in that room who are gay, and maybe they're not out, and you say this in a negative way, there's a negative association between being gay and some clothing or something, right? You could be hurting their feelings. And then maybe you didn't intend to hurt their feelings, but you have to think about that before you say things like that, right? And by the way, this is... Do you remember in the first Republican debate when Megyn Kelly... Is she from upstate New York? All right, there you go. Local success story there, Megyn Kelly. Well, more successful every moment. Anyways, she asked Donald Trump about, she quoted him as making a series of incredibly misogynist comments, and doesn't that suggest that he has a temperament that might not be suited to high political office? And part of his response was, we have too much political correctness in this country, and he got a big applause. And from that moment on, that became part of the Donald Trump campaign and part of the discourse about the Trump campaign. So I can't resist giving a mini history of political, you know what political correctness is? Political correctness is a term that came out of the social movements of the 1960s, the civil rights movements, the women's and gay and lesbian movements, et cetera. The social movements of the 1960s, people would say to each other, checking each other on the use of language to perpetuate inequality and injustice, because language is powerful, right? It's very powerful. And so this is, by the way, this discussion about political correctness is all about power, in case you didn't know. And so the idea was people on the left would say to each other, you can't say that, that's not politically correct. You can't say that's a lame joke, because that's that's people with disabilities are often called, you know, historically lame, and it was a kind of a put down. And so if you just say that's a lame joke, you're just perpetuating that stereotype, and it's an ableist kind of comment, and that's not politically correct. And what happened was, because this is about power, because language is power, there was a pushback against this because it started being successful. In other words, there was starting to be a success at people checking their illegitimate use of power through language about racism, about sexism, about heterosexism, and other things. There was a pushback against this, because anytime you advance the cause of democracy, there's going to be resistance, and the forces of tradition are going to push back against democratizing change. This is how it happens. And so political correctness then became this term that anytime you challenge people on making statements or enacting some through language some kind of privilege illegitimately, it was then said, oh, you're just being politically correct. And it was a way to blunt the force of the forward movement of democracy. And now, most people don't even know any of this. They just think, yo, you're being politically correct because you're not saying the truth. You're not saying what you're thinking. As if checking yourself before you make a racist or a sexist or a heterosexist comment is a problem, when in fact it's actually a strength. It actually suggests you're courageous enough to be introspective and thinking about the effects of your words. And I don't think we should make apologies for that. I think we should push back against that. And again, this is all about power. If anybody wants to read a linguistic discussion of this very thing, there's a linguist by the name of Robin Lakoff who wrote a book called The Language Wars, and she has a whole chapter about the history of the word political correctness. And it gives a pretty good summary for people's interest. Yes, sir.
So my comment was just about some of the reason I think people...
Keep the mic close.
Some of the reason I think people are against political correctness is because... Well, America's like one of the few places in the world where you have freedom of speech, and you can even look at Canada where they don't even have that. They're trying to remove that right now with WHAM 103. So it's pretty horrifying when they do. So I think that's just why some people they fight back against political correctness, because they just don't want to find themselves in a situation where they're going to jail because of an internet comment they made like 2 years ago. You know, they don't want to find themselves in a place where they've lost their job, their life, and everything. I'm not saying that's what you want. Oh, sorry, I'm not saying that's what you want. I'm not impugning your character at all. But I'm just trying to say that that's the camp from which some people are coming from. So I'm not saying at all that's what you want. I'm just saying, is in their defense, because, I'm one of those people.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I would just say, in a society, in a democratic society such as ours, questions and concepts like free speech and the limitations of free speech, and with now the new internet space, the digital universe, which is creating all kinds of new, both in law and social practice, like unprecedented questions about what is speech and how do you limit speech and regulate it. These are all contested areas, right? People are, there's no settled, law or even social practice around what is considered acceptable speech. It's part of, if you think about it as part of human societies trying to organize themselves in the most effective ways possible, these are constantly contentious issues. And political correctness has become a catch word, if you will. I mean, I agree, there's all kinds of complexities about people being held accountable for things they might have said, now, because there's a surveillance culture that didn't exist when I was younger. And a lot of people in my age group are happy that we didn't have cell phones when we were in college. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Are you kidding me? Because now it's like something could be captured on video or audio in a way that you're like, oh no, you don't want anybody. And so that's another whole thing that people are getting used to. But I think in a more narrow, limited sense, this notion of political correctness is often used to talk about people who are reluctant to make openly racist, sexist, heterosexist comments rather than all the other complex issues relating to free speech. But I appreciate your point. Somebody else? Quick comments, questions? Over there. Here's a mic coming up.
I don't really need it. But anyway, I just think that what's going on in America, and it's been going on in America, with gender, sex, racism, more than anything, economic power, we still think we're living in 1985. And we're not living in 1985 because of the digital age, because of all the other things that are out here. And Americans better start thinking about, when you do talk, black or white, or any other thing, you better start thinking about how you're going to say it with the type of verbiage you're going to say it. Because we're not doing that no more. They're not even teaching that anymore. So that's my comment. And also, white America has to think about its own issues, because they're pushing some of those issues onto other folk of color.
Absolutely. Thank you. I mean, I mean, just like I was saying at the beginning that we need a paradigm shift to understand gender violence is a men's issue, not a women's issue that good men help out with. I think racism is clearly a white person's issue. I mean, heterosexism is a heterosexual person's issue. I mean, a lot of white people are very uncomfortable talking about race. And but that's what you have to do. I mean, I think a lot of men are uncomfortable talking about gender. I think that's, but you have to go into those spaces. If you really want to make the change that has to happen, people have to step out of their comfort zone. As I said right at the beginning, the idea that somehow there's going to be unanimity of opinion, everybody's going to feel good, everybody's going to be agreeing with each other, that's an unrealistic expectation. If you're talking about helping people to navigate some of these complexities of gender and race and sexual orientation, the world is changing very quickly. And by the way, in my writing and speaking about the about say sexual assault prevention and gender violence prevention on college campuses, people so often have this narrow understanding of why we should be doing this work. And the narrow understanding is because there's a certain number of rapes that happen on campus and it happened during the college years, and we need to keep our students safe, especially our women students, but also our men students, safe during that period, and so that we're going to do sexual assault prevention and all these other initiatives because of that. And my argument is this isn't just about keeping people safe during their college years. These are life skills. I mean, has anybody paid attention to the news in the last few weeks? I've been on all these radio programs in the last just a couple weeks. Kay Jewelers, this huge scandal. It was Signet, with the parent company of Kay Jewelers and Jared Jewelers. You know what I'm talking about? This is like huge settlements going to be coming out, like multi-millions of dollars that Signet's going to end up paying if what I'm reading is correct, because the culture of sexual harassment in this company, at least alleged right now, the Marine Corps scandal, we could go on and on about these various institutional failures in the business world, in the professional world, in way beyond the immediate educational space. So in other words, if we're training young men to be citizens of their society, to be good professionals, to be working in workplaces in a gender and sexually diverse and racially diverse society, this stuff is going to be part of the education, not just because we have to keep students safe, however important that is. You follow me on this? I've been increasingly working in the corporate world, because they're looking at the bottom line. They're not. It's not social justice for them. It's more like, how do we number one, prevent lawsuits, and number two, How do we maximize profits by having more talented women in the workplace? And we can't have talented women in the workplace if all these practices are going on that are keeping talented women away. This is real world stuff, in other words. And it goes way beyond 18 to 22 year olds on a college campus. It's life skills. Yes, yes. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
My question to you is, so you spoke earlier about in order to lessen the severity of these issues like domestic violence, gay bashing, and bullying, we need people of status to speak out, right? Or men of status to basically speak out, correct?
Just one addendum. I mean, I think we need people at all levels, but if you get men, in this case, if you get men who have some stature to do it, it opens up space beyond their immediate subculture, but go ahead.
Yeah, so based on that point, do you think that the reputation of these men matter? Let's say a football player who got in trouble for domestic abuse, is it as effective as him speaking or a football player who's basically has a clean slate, they're not known for committing any of these, right? Or is it effective that both speak out?
That's a good question. I think it's effective that both speak out for different reasons, and it's not just, I'm not just talking about high profile people. I'm talking about in peer cultures, large and small, if more guys would, instead of being silent in the face of their friends' expressions of sexism or racism or what have you, they would challenge them and make it clear that that's not cool, then we would see significant change. If men who have stature do it, they have a bigger platform. And in fact, I'm going to give you an example, because I'm glad you asked me this question. I know we have other questions, but give me a moment. Is Anthony still back there in the control room? Okay. I want to show you. I want to give you an example of a clip. It's a short clip, and it's from about 2 years ago, on Fox News Sunday. No, Fox Sports Sunday, I think. And the Ray Rice incident, right? Baltimore Ravens occasioned a shift that's happened in the sports culture. And again, we're a long way to go in the sports culture. But after the second video was released, not the first video that showed him dragging his then fiancée Janae Palmer out of the elevator, but the second video, which showed him punching her in the face, a new conversation started in the male sports culture. And for the first time, you saw male athletes, coaches, and commentators actually criticizing another man in the sports culture for his behavior around women. Up to that point, and I'm somebody who's been following this for 25, 30 years, up to that point, it's very rare. In fact, I don't remember one incident where men in the sports culture made a critical comment about another man who was charged with sexual assault or domestic violence. They would always say, if anything, to the camera, our thoughts and prayers are with the family. This is a very difficult time, and our teammate, et cetera, has gone through some struggles in his family, and we just hope they work things out or whatever. They wouldn't say anything about the behavior. By the way, if it was racism, they would say something. That's an example of the disparity. I mean, I'm not saying we don't have racism, but I mean, if somebody in the sports culture made a racist comment, there would be public criticism of him, but not around gender until the second Ray Rice video. And I want to share with you an example of the new conversation that's happening, and it's very brief, but when we come back from it, I just want to make a quick point. So Anthony, if you could roll the Terry Bradshaw clip, please.
Hardy was convicted by a judge last year on two counts of assault on a woman, but there's a quirk in the law in Carolinas where you can go before a jury trial, but what happened was that the alleged victim failed to show up, is thrown out. So he gets a full year's pay, $13 million, then comes back this year and has to lay out the first four games. All right, fine. Now, anybody, in my opinion, that lays a hand on a woman, I don't care who you are, my friend, you never come back in this league. But Dallas Cowboys owner Jerry Jones, in his desperation to get a pass rusher, said, well, you know what, America, a Cowboy fans, he's all right. He's a good boy. We're going to get him all straightened out over here and bring him in there, which he did. He has a first news conference. He makes a fool of himself. And then Jerry goes out and says, well, Elizabeth, he basically becomes an enabler himself. This is wrong. We have no place for this. And I'm actually tired of talking about the Hardys of the world. And I really, really seriously hope that eventually we never have a place in the NFL for people that touch a woman, strike a woman.
So this is something that you wouldn't have seen 5 years ago, or 10 years ago, or 20 years. I'm telling you, you just didn't see it. And I just want to make one quick observation, and then a couple other questions. Then I want to get to some media, really. I'll show you some clips. But Terry Bradshaw, who's a white man, middle-aged white man of stature, Hall of Fame quarterback, et cetera, was criticizing a young black male athlete who deserved to be criticized, Greg Hardy. But he's kind of punching down, in a sense, because he has more stature. But then he pivoted, and he punched up, and he criticized Jerry Jones, the white owner of the Dallas Cowboys. And did you see the other panelists? It's like, right? That was the most interesting moment for me. It's like this, because it's so rare to see a powerful man challenge an even more powerful man in this context. That rarely happens. Yeah,
it was cricket. Believe me, that's all.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
I caught that too.
I'm sure. Sir, do you want to ask a question? Make a comment?
Yeah, my comment was I did 20 years in the military, and you probably remember Tailhook.
Uh-huh.
I was a Navy corpsman at the time, and then I served with the Marine Corps during Desert Storm. My whole 20-year career, and I still work for the DOD, every year we have sexual assault training, some kind. Right now we're going through transgender training. Military that's already in, and when they starting to come in the military. But my comment is that I can't believe to this day this is still going on. But it's the underlying culture that it's like a warrior type thinking that we gotta let them give off steam. They warriors, they go to war, they get shot at, they kill people, so they have to let off this steam so they allow that to happen until they get caught. And then they come do the tough talk like they was doing on there. Give it another 5 years, it's going to happen again. So it really comes from the leaders. And like you were saying, you know, I'm a supervisor in my office, and I don't allow, you know, cursing, you know, dirty jokes, anything like that. I stop it before it starts. And that's what have to happen from the leaders from the booths on up have to stop that culture. If they don't, it's going to be underlined, it's going to rear its ugly head in the next 5 or 6 years. We're going to be shaking our head again. Like, what lesson did we learn? And I think that's the bad part about it. Just they give them those they're warriors, they need to let off steam. It's, to me, it's the same thing with police departments, with killing unarmed people. They want their cops to be aggressive. That's why cops don't go to jail, because they want them to be aggressive, so they don't want to send a message, a cop to be hesitant when they have to do their job. So that's why it's really hard to convict cops, and that's why it's really hard to change that culture in the military, because it's that warrior type of thinking that they have.
Thank you. No, thank you very much for your comment and your service. You raise a lot of important points. Just one brief response, and then I'm going to shift gears because of the time constraints. I do want to show you a couple of clips about media and the role of media, okay? All right. You know, in 1948, President Harry Truman signed an executive order integrating the United States Armed Forces. By executive authority, there was lots of resistance to the executive order because there was lots of racist white people in the military, white men in particular, who didn't want to take orders from African Americans and others. And yet it had the authority of the presidency, and eventually the executive order was enacted and the military was integrated. And today it's the most integrated workplace in the United States. Sports and military are the two most integrated workplaces in the United States. And while it doesn't mean that there's no racism in the military dealt with racism and said, this is not acceptable. We're going to hold people accountable for acting in these ways, and this is not our fighting force, if you will. And we're in a similar place when it comes to gender and sexual orientation. These are changes that are transforming the society, therefore changing and transforming the military. People who say, for example, we're the military, we're not a social engineering, you know, this is a social engineering project, we're the military, we're the warriors. This is an ignorant statement that people make without any understanding of their own history. There used to be a sergeant major that I worked with when we started in the Marine Corps when we started in 1997, who had been in 28 years at the time, which means that he was a Vietnam era guy, you know, from a previous generation. He was on his way to 30 years and out. But he was one of the top enlisted ranks, the top enlisted rank in the Marine Corps. He used to say, "The Marine Corps, 200 and plus years of tradition, unimpeded by progress." And it was kind of a funny line, but it was not true. It was factually incorrect every time he said it, because the Marine Corps has been changing the whole time. And the racial integration is one example of that. It's this idea that somehow this is social engineering is just an ignorant statement. Militaries are always have complex relationships to the society that produces them. And one of the reasons why the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy was revoked was because the troops wanted it revoked, because the generals sitting in their offices know that the 18-year-old troops didn't care, and in fact were supportive of more open sexual orientation spectrum than the generals were. And the generals have to keep the troops happy. And so, I mean, this was generational change right there. And so the idea somehow that the military can't, I'm not saying you're saying this at all, but I'm saying the idea that somehow the military can't figure out how to create a warrior class and treat women with respect sells those men short, because of course they can do both, have a warrior class and be respectful to women at the same time. And I think because people, this is, by the way, this whole boys will be boys thing, right? Boys will be boys, which I think this last election was the exemplified, this boys will be boys, the power of that idiocy to still reign in this country, the idea that boys will be boys. It's like people who say boys will be boys are often saying it to defend bad behavior by boys and men, right? What do you expect? Boys will be boys. They have this testosterone coursing through their veins. They can't, you know, what are they can't control themselves. You know, they just got to push that girl up against the wall because they're boys, right? But you know what? That's really an anti-male statement, because it's saying that boys and men are not moral actors and agents who can make ethical decisions about how. We're just beasts. You know what I mean? We just have this hormonal urge to do something, and we can't control ourselves. That's an anti-male statement. In fact, feminists are much more pro-male, because feminists expect more from men. And yet feminists get called anti-male, and people who say boys will be boys get called pro-male. It's so stupid. And by the way, can I also say, thank you, can I also say, what you hear on Fox News and other parts of the culture around issues relating to talking about masculinities and talking about men, whether it's on college campuses and men engaging with these more complicated conversations about gender and the transformations that are happening, is you'll hear, you're just trying to make men into girls, boys into girls, you're wussifying America. That's the term that they use all the time, wussification. This is the wussification of America. Hi, Greg Rutfield and Fox and friends, if you want to watch the video. They say it's the wussification of America, right? In other words, the implication is that talking about this and helping men think through these things is somehow making them soft. And soft is equated with feminine, which is also sexist, by the way. But it's another absurdity. Because what it really is a discussion about what is strength. At its root, the conversation really should go to, what does it mean to be strong? Because I want to be strong as a man, and I want my son to be strong. The question is, how do you define strength? The definition of strength, and I think that the definition of strength, the chest beating, I can dominate you with my will or my physical power, is such an antiquated and ridiculously narrow understanding of strength. It's like we want people to be strong, but strong in men to be strong, but strong in for what? In standing for justice, in standing for dignity, in standing up against violence and abuse and harassment, not just dominating another person through your force of will or physical strength. And that's part of what depressed a lot of people about this last election is because to me that was just a caricature of the old failed model of masculinity that was ratified by 60 million people. Like that's somehow strong to be, you know, pounding your chest and picking on people and bullying people. That's a measure of strength. I'm sorry, I don't buy that for 1 second. And the idea that you can't apologize because if you apologize, you're admitting weakness. This is Cro-Magnon level. I mean, this is literally Neanderthal level of moral imagination, right? How many people in the 21st century, can we actually believe that it's weak to admit weakness? It's weak to admit that you made a mistake? But it's strong to pretend you didn't make a mistake? This is absurdity on a high level. And I think one of the teachable moments of this the Trump presidency is we have an ongoing lesson in what we've been working against for the last 50 years of trying to redefine masculinity in a much healthier and more complex way. Because what we have on stage on a daily basis at the White House is, I think, a totally failed model that has been hugely destructive in the world. And by the way, one of the things that I didn't say at the beginning about this, all the different connections between all the issues, men's violence against women is connected to men's violence against other men and men's violence against themselves. And you know, I'm wearing the white ribbon, right? Michael Kaufman, who's the co-founder of the White Ribbon Campaign in Canada, and then it's global. The campaign that you're doing is also a global campaign. Michael Kaufman wrote a piece in 1987 called The Triad of Men's Violence, connecting men's violence against women to men's violence against other men to men's violence against themselves. And you know, we have a big problem, because they're all connected, by the way. The same system that produces men who abuse women produces men who abuse other men, produces men who don't take care of themselves. And in fact, gun violence, which is a huge problem, as we all know, you know, the single biggest category of gun violence deaths every year is suicide by gun, and the primary victims of suicide by gun are white men over the age of 50. Right? All these issues are connected and interconnected. And so again, people who are sophisticated make these kind of connections, so they don't just see these issues in silos. They make these kind of connections. Okay, I'm going to stop what I've just been going, the roads that I've been going down, and come back, because I'm pushing it now in terms of your indulgence of a long day and long evening. But let me just, I'm going to give you a couple clips because I keep promising the idea that media has to be part of the conversation. I'm going to show you a couple clips. One of them is going to be from one of my films. I make these educational documentaries about the representation of masculinities in the media. And I want to share with you a clip from my first film. It's called Tough Guys, G-U-I-S-E. The update of Tough Guys was Tough Guys 2, came out about almost 4 years ago, which I can't even believe. But this this particular clip deals with how the size of men's bodies has increased over the past several decades in media representation and how the brutality of the narratives about men achieving a certain kind of masculinity have gotten more and more brutal, including brutal against women. There is some violence in this clip because the film is about violence. And so if you don't want to watch something, just turn your head or look away. There's a very brief scene of sexualized violence. Again, it'll go quickly, but it's there. So I just wanted to tell you that. So the goal of this film and this work more generally is to help people think critically about the role of media. I'm not arguing, nor does any thoughtful critic of media argue that media is causing people, men or women, boys or girls, to commit violence. It's about the great norming force that media has, the narratives and stories that are told, the representations, the ideologies and belief systems that are fostered. It's not about whether an individual boy or a young man watching a movie or playing a video game is then going to go out and imitate what he's seen. That's ridiculously reductive. It's about much deeper meaning that's attached to these narratives. And so media literacy education has to be part of the educational system in our country. We live in a totally media-soaked environment, and we have to be more critical. The media corporations want our kids and us to be robotic consumers who just go to the movie, pay the money, go through the turnstile, buy the product tie-in, download the app. But if we want to be more thoughtful people and engaged citizens of a democratic society, we really have to be much more critical than that. And I hope that this is at least a teaser as to how that works. So Anthony, if you could roll Upping the Ante 2014, part one, please. The American ideal of the real man owes a lot to the Hollywood Western and the ultimate icon of white American masculinity, John Wayne.
Young fella, if you're looking for trouble, I'll accommodate you.
While other men talked a lot, thought too much, equivocated, and showed emotion, John Wayne made the world bend to his will with just a stare, a few words, his fists, and his guns.
I haven't lost my temper in 40 years, but Pilgrim, you caused a lot of trouble this morning. Might have got somebody killed, and somebody ought to belt you in the mouth. But I won't. I won't. The hell I won't.
You won't get away with it, Cody.
Cody, huh? You've got a good memory for names. You're good.
And then there's Hollywood gangster films with cinematic tough guys like James Cagney and Humphrey Bogart.
One move out of you, son, I'll fill your pants full of lead. Get over there.
Men hardened by the world who knew the power of a few clipped words and a few rounds of ammunition.
Humphrey Bogart, James Cagney. They pitched me to talk. I like those guys.
Come on. And this equation between toughness, manhood, and violence has continued and in many ways intensified over time.
Say hello to my little friend!
There's no question that over the past few decades, there's been a ratcheting up of what it takes to be considered a real man. Look at our action heroes. In the 1950s, Superman was the equivalent of an ordinary guy running around in tights and a cape. And today, he's pumped up and ripped. Well, look at Batman. The body of Adam West as Batman in the 1960s is a far cry from the far more imposing Dark Knight of the 21st century. Pro wrestlers' bodies in the 1960s were more flabby. In the 21st century, they're way more sculpted, pumped up, and ripped. And look at toy action figures. If you look at the Star Wars toy figurines that kids played with in the 1970s and contrast them with the Star Wars toy figurines that are being marketed to kids today, you see a dramatic shift. Well, look at the body of G.I. Joe. A study done in the late 1990s found that over the past 50 years, the size of G.I. Joe's biceps, in real-life equivalents, increased from 12.2 inches in 1964 to 15.2 inches in 1974 to 16.4 inches in 1994 and up to 26.8 inches by 1998. If you wanted a comparison to a real person, the biceps of someone like The Rock are reportedly only about 20 inches. Over the same time period, there's been a ratcheting up of violence itself. We've gone from pistols in the 1940s to larger weaponry in the 1970s to the increasing militarization of these weapons in the 80s and 90s to the larger-than-life heavy metal killing machines we have today.
You mustn't be afraid to dream a little bigger, darling.
Say hello to my little friend!
Let him up!
seen video game violence go from the benign aggressions of Pac-Man, Space Invaders, and Asteroids to the unimaginable and hyper-realistic bloodbaths of today's game.
Get off me!
We've gone from the comparatively orderly sport of boxing to today's number one fighting sport, the street fighting viciousness of mixed martial arts and cage fighting.
Oh! Wow! Back up, kid!
We are underway!
This place is deafening!
Popular men's sports often seem to be less about healthy competition than about proving toughness through physical force and violence, and dominating and humiliating the opposition. Then, on a parallel track, we've seen porn culture go from the softcore sexism of Hugh Hefner's brand of hedonistic masculinity in the 1950s to the hardcore misogyny and sexualized brutality in the gonzo porn that is so popular with guys today.
Dude, I'm kind of uncomfortable watching this with you. Dude, learn to like it.
You have a long-standing cultural narrative that says being a man is about sexual conquest.
So did you bang her?
Oh, yeah, I banged her.
That's what a man does, okay?
That's why you need to stop being a pussy and nail her, okay?
How do you not see the point? There's the point.
The message to young men here is that actually caring about girls and women is unmanly and gay.
I need a little bit more time with Carly. There, I said it, okay? And I know you think that's lame, but can you please just give me one more day?
That's not lame, bro. That's gay.
What most discussions about violence miss is how interconnected this larger story about manhood is, how it creates a kind of all-pervasive cultural script that says sexual conquest, physical toughness, force, and violence are legitimate ways for men to achieve and maintain power and control. We're used to seeing the glamorization of hypermasculine posturing. We're not nearly as used to thinking about the unglamorous, ugly, mean-spirited, and violent ways these images play out in the real world.
Okay, so that's kind of a teaser, because that's a movie that's, you know, 78 minutes or 60 minutes or 42 minutes in the high school version. There's so much to say and to use media to make these kind of points. And this is one, that was just one example of the many. I'm just gonna go over about 5 minutes. So I appreciate if people want to hang. If you have to leave, then I'm not gonna be offended. But I'm just gonna show you a trailer for a film and then a closing 90-second piece. So It'll just be about 5 minutes, okay? The trailer that I'm gonna show you is for a film called The Mask You Live In. The Mask You Live In is a film that was made by Jennifer Siebel Newsom, whose first film was called Misrepresentation. Misrepresentation was about how the representation of women and girls in a multicultural, multiracial, multiethnic sense in media, and especially in entertainment culture, in other words, the hypersexualization of women and the emphasis on women's bodies and looks undermines often women's sense of themselves as anything other than the object of heterosexual male desire, and which undermines women's sense of themselves as political actors or professionals or what have you. And by the way, it undermines men's thinking about women as full human beings. In other words, this representational system, especially in entertainment culture, has a real powerful effect. And Misrepresentation as a film makes that point with interviews with women, men, girls, boys, and racially and ethnically diverse cast, if you will, of intellectuals as well as, you know, kids in high school. Their follow-up film to that is called The Mask You Live In, and it's about boys. And it's about not necessarily how media images, although media images are part of it, but just how cultural constructs and attitudes and ideologies about manhood are powerful in the lives of boys and shaping the understanding that boys have of themselves and men have of themselves. And I wanted to just share with you the trailer to this film, and I know George and his colleagues use the film in educational outreach and such like that, but for those of you who aren't acquainted with it, this stuff is, by the way, on Netflix. So The Mask You Live In, you can get on Netflix. Misrepresentation, you can get on Netflix. So I just wanted to share that with you. And so I want to share with you, Anthony, if you could roll the trailer to The Mask You Live In, please.
Stop crying.
Stop with the tears.
Don't cry.
Pick yourself up.
Stop with the emotion.
Don't be a pussy.
Don't let nobody disrespect you.
Be cool and be kind of a dick.
Always keep your mouth shut.
Nobody likes a tattletale.
Bros come before hoes.
Don't let your woman run your life.
You a bitch.
What a fag.
Get laid. Do something.
Be a man.
Be a man.
Grow some balls.
The three most destructive words that every man receives when he's a boy is when he's told to be a man.
We've constructed an idea of masculinity in the United States that doesn't give young boys a way to feel secure in their masculinity, so we make them go prove it all the time.
Within their peer group culture, each of them is posturing based on how the other boys are posturing, and what they end up missing is what they each really want, which is just that closeness.
In good times, guys are like really close to each other, but when things get a little bit worse, you're on your own.
From middle school, I had 4 really close friends. Once I kind of went into high school, I struggle finding people I can talk to because I feel like I'm not supposed to get help.
Our kids get up every morning. They have to prepare their mask for how they're gonna walk to school. A lot of our students don't know how to take the mask off. What is it you don't let people see? Almost 90% of you have pain and anger on the back of that paper.
If you never cry, then you have all these feelings stuffed up inside of you, and then you can't get them out.
They really buy into a culture that doesn't value what we've feminized. If we're in a culture that doesn't value caring, doesn't value relationships, doesn't value empathy, you are going to have boys and girls, men and women, go crazy.
I had anger issues in high school. I felt like an outcast.
I've been suspended at least once every year I was here.
We would just look for trouble and just like try to fight.
Boys are more likely to act out. They're more likely to become aggressive. Most people miss that as depression, or see it as a conduct disorder, or just a bad kid.
I felt like just giving up on life. You know, I just had suicide thoughts in my head at 6th grade.
I felt alone for a long time, and I actually thought about killing myself.
Whether it's homicidal violence or suicidal violence, people resort to such desperate behavior only when they are feeling shamed and humiliated, or feel they would be if they didn't prove that they were real men.
If you're told from day one, don't let nobody disrespect you, and this is the way you handle it as a man, respect is linked to violence.
If I can man up, why step down from that? You feel me?
It's like instinct.
So man up!
Man up!
Man up!
Man up!
Throw some fucking balls!
Act like a man!
Be a man!
Be a man!
For my kids, I was gonna end this hyper-masculine narrative here.
So, another important piece and a great educational tool. You can see it at home. It can be used in educational context and with sparking discussion and dialogue. There's curricula associated with this. There's a lot of good stuff out there. In other words, we're not starting from scratch anymore in terms of trying to have thoughtful educational interventions and dialogues about these subjects. Does anybody want to make a quick comment or ask a question about the media discussion? Because I know I'm going through stuff quickly.
I'm going to put a plug in for another Netflix documentary called The Hunting Ground. Excellent. I mean, had me call my daughter and tell her to watch it. She's a college student down in North Carolina. Great, great documentary.
Okay, thank you. Hunting Ground. It's about sexual assault on college campuses and the failures of a lot of administrations to effectively address the issues in front of them. Thank you. Anybody else want to say anything about the media discussion? Hang in, we're almost done. We have one more 90-second spot.
There was this really good book called Trouble with Boys that it talks about the school system and how that doesn't really do boys justice because, you know, guys learn differently and how they're supposed to, like, sit down for hours on end and just, like, read a piece of paper, and now that doesn't really work for them. So sometimes, you know, that energy comes out in different ways, and also they end up failing in school because of that, so they feel like even bigger failures. So, you know, they just become, like, washouts, dropouts. They fall into bad habits, stuff like that. I thought that was pretty interesting, too.
Well said. I can't really improve upon that. Thank you. There's so much. I mean, I hope people, by the way, know that and see the organic connection between looking critically at least for these brief moments, at how the narrow definitions of masculinities as connected with, you know, keeping it all in, power and dominance and all that kind of stuff, and men's violence against women and men's violence against other men. And in other words, thinking critically about raising healthy boys, if you will, and healthy men is a critical piece of reducing violence. You know, Frederick Douglass, one of the great Americans who's doing good work these days. Frederick Douglass has been doing some good work. You know, by the way, Frederick Douglass was born an enslaved person and became an advisor to President Lincoln and a major figure in the abolition of slavery movement and a prominent 19th century supporter of women's rights. Did you know that about Frederick Douglass? So Frederick Douglass was way ahead of the curve. One of the things that he said related to this subject matter is it's much easier to build healthy children than to repair broken men. It's much easier to build healthy children than to repair broken men. So a big part of, I think, the work that has to happen is those of us who are fathers, uncles, teachers, coaches, mothers, aunts, you know, teachers, in other words, women and men who have boys in our care, if you will, whether it's personally or professionally or whatever, have an powerful role to play in helping boys become better men, if you will, especially in a culture that's giving them all kinds of mixed signals. And people always say this to me, like, what do you say to your son or what do you say to young men when you're living in a culture where there's so many examples of really dysfunctional masculinity, but it's on some level it's rewarded in many instances. And you know, right? On one level we can say bullying is wrong, treat people with respect. And then you see all these examples of powerful men who are bullies and who don't treat people with respect, and they make a lot of money and they achieve lots of success and power. And so it's I think one of the ways to respond to that is just to say our society is sending mixed messages. I'm not gonna, you know, why fool around? Our society is sending mixed messages, but we expect more from you. I expect more from you than that, you know? So I'm going to leave you on a positive note with this last piece, and here's the context. Eve Ensler, the playwright, founded an organization called, well, V-Day, and then she founded this event called 1 Billion Rising, which is every day on Valentine's Day, the celebration of women's strength and resilience in the face of deep misogyny and men's violence against them globally. Eve Ensler, like so many women in this work, has been frustrated by the fact that men haven't been present enough. There haven't been enough men. There's been some, and it's a growing movement of men, and clearly in this room and elsewhere. But I mean, it's a tiny number of men compared to the level of the problem. And so she wrote this poem as a way to try to touch men's hearts. And it's called The Man Prayer, and it was put to video and music by a man named Tony Strobel, and it was released in concert with the opening Billion Rising event. And again, you'll see that this is an attempt to say to men, there's a way of thinking beyond the narrow confines of traditional notions of masculinity to try to expand that horizon, and that we're going to be doing not just women a favor, or helping women, but we're going to be helping men and ourselves in that process. And I want to leave you after this long night with the man prayer. So Anthony, if you could roll the man prayer, please.
जो जानने से अधिक सुनने की सराहन करता है
che cerca la bontà oltre il controllo
che chora quando a dor è profonda
Μη φοβάμαι να χαθώ.
Puedo apreciar una caricia más que el rendimiento.
Μια φορά, μια ας μου αρέσει.
Lass mich langsam bewegen und nicht schnell.
Могу быть и храбр, да уда мой страх и срамоту.
На никусанье он на уме вине, но фанье его вине.
Que je cesse de prétendre. Et ouvre toutes mes parties, restées trop longtemps endormies.
May I cherish, respect, and love my mother.
وأترجم صدى الحب لها لمحبة كل النساء والكائنات الحية.
Thank you very much, and good evening.
Jackson Katz. Thank you to Jackson.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I just want to point out to you that in your handouts, we have three things. One is 10 things that men can do to prevent gender violence. That's the yellow sheet. The purple sheet is some other resources that Jackson Katz recommends. And the green sheet, we might think, is the most important sheet, which is the sheet that asks you, what are you going to do next? So you came, you heard a presentation. Now, what are you going to do? If you liked the video that you saw earlier, the To Be a Man video, that video is available free. And if you would like to request a copy of that or fill out this form and we'll gladly hand you one free. We'll also, if you want us to come and do a facilitated discussion, if you want us to come do prevention programming, if you want to participate in the 12 men model like my colleagues from the 100 Black Men or the Omega Psi Phi Fraternity or Lemoyne College who did that, if you want to participate in the White Ribbon Campaign, if you want to join the Alliance for Sexual Assault Prevention at Upstate, if you want to join the Vera House Pride Coalition to prevent LGBT relationship and sexual violence, if you want to schedule a prevention program, if you want to be added to the Vera House email list, or you want to support the MVP program, Coaching Boys Into Men, or Men of Strength project that we are all doing right now through the Vera House Prevention Education Team, we ask you to make that commitment. Yes, you all heard some very powerful words today, but we hope that it's the beginning of your commitment and your activism to continuing to do this work. On behalf of Vera House, once again, please let's give it up for Dr. Jackson Katz. And if you want to run up to Jackson and ask him some other questions, take a picture, take a selfie, go ahead on and do that.